Yeah, so the idea for this workshop, and I think we're going to have another one in the winter and the spring, is to introduce you to some writing concepts that we use in clinics over at the University of Michigan. Beginning with perhaps the most important, a writing principle of all, the force of focus. So the force of focus is something we use every day in the Human Trafficking Clinic. It's something we use every day in the Child Welfare Clinic. I'm pretty sure the other clinics use it too. They just don't necessarily call it this yet. The sort of easy way to think about the force of focus is to think about the difference between saying a glass is half full and a glass is half empty. But we kind of want to push beyond that. We want to get to something more sophisticated. So we actually want to talk about how the words you choose can change the world people see. And to do that, often in the clinic, we talk about this in terms of advocacy. So we kind of need some working definitions of advocacy. I'm going to call on people just because it will be a little bit easier. So right in the first row, do you want to mind reading what we have, working definitions of advocacy? Advocacy is?
The best words in the best order.
Or advocacy is?
Getting something right in language.
Or advocacy is?
Making order out of chaos.
Yeah, and so this is all these sort of things, particularly when we're putting together appellate briefs in the Child Welfare Clinic. But in talking to Dean Gardner, and you had this new leadership initiative, and it started to think about it, and it's also a way to define leadership. So leadership can be the best words in the best order. Leadership can be getting something right in language, and leadership certainly is, as we're going to see, making order out of chaos. To get some help doing this, we're going to turn to Daniel Kahneman and his book, Thinking Fast and Slow, on a macro level, on what leadership is. On a micro level, we're going to turn to this human trafficking textbook that I got a chance to work on over at the Michigan Clinic. And then, most exciting of all, as a model, we're going to look at Elle Woods and Legally Blonde. So that's going to come at the end. Wait for that. It's going to be really, really fun and exciting. But for now, we're going to turn to the world of sports. So is anybody from the University of Michigan? Did anyone go to the university? Yes. So what's your name?
Emily.
Do you remember that? So you're nodding your head. What was it? Do you remember what was happening? This is the 2013 Outback Bowl. So Michigan was playing South Carolina. What's happening in that picture, Emily? Yeah, so that's the defensive end for South Carolina. Jadeveon Clowney is one of the, I think maybe the number one draft pick in the NFL, or at least number two. Big, big recruit. And he decapitated a Michigan running back. You can actually see it a little bit better in this photo. That's the dude's helmet. That's the ball. And if you're a Michigan fan, that's a really painful thing to watch. I mean, one thing you could think about is sort of like, what if you're that dude's mom? And over again on ESPN, you're just seeing your little boy being decapitated. It was sort of like if anyone was a Jet fan and they saw the butt fumble by Mark Chances, where he ran into his offensive lineman's butt and then fumbled. And over on SportsCenter. But what was actually the worst picture in the Michigan-South Carolina game was this shot, Emily. Do you remember what happened at the end of the game? So Michigan was up most of this game against South Carolina. And then with 11 seconds left, South Carolina throws this touchdown pass. This dude runs it in for a score. So they're up the whole game. And then they lose. It's this really, really bitter defeat. So the next day, Emily, in the Detroit Free Press, they have this headline. You want to read that for us? Why is that a really good headline? And I'll give you sort of a way to think about what a good headline is, or even good writing in general. Good writing in general answers two questions. Who is the audience? What is the function? Anytime you sit down to write a brief, every time you sit down to write a mission statement, anytime you sit down to write an undergraduate paper or a law school paper, you always want to ask this question. Who's the audience? Who am I writing to? And what am I trying to do with this piece of writing? So Emily, who's the audience of the Detroit Free Press?
Well, it's people in the Metro Detroit area, which is disproportionately Michigan fans.
Wonderful. And what's the function of that headline? So people have watched this game. Michigan fans have watched this game. What are they thinking? What is the headline trying to capture? Exactly. It's trying to capture the hurt. So that's a really good headline. It would be a terrible headline in the Charleston Post and Courier, which is a newspaper in South Carolina. Why would it be a terrible headline in the Charleston Post and Courier, Emily? Yeah, so this is the actual headline in the South Carolina Post and Courier. South Carolina beats Michigan in thrilling Outback Bowl. And notice the difference. First headline, Gamecocks big play produced bitter end. Second one, beats Michigan in thrilling. It's the same game. That's really, really important when any time you sit down to write a brief. You're going to have two sides of the same story. For one, folks, they're going to try and convince you that it's bitter. Another set of folks on the other side is going to try and convince you that it's thrilling. Who's the audience? What's the function? Another way to sort of simplify this is just to say, look, one way we can describe this game is that Michigan lost. Another way we can describe this game is that South Carolina won. What's the difference between those two, Emily?
Between this one you just had up or between the fact that one lost and one won?
Well, yeah, one lost, one won. So what's the story of Michigan lost? Where does our attention focus? And what else? Sort of like what they did to lose, right? So you might focus on the bad defensive back coverage. You might focus on the missed opportunities. Where do you focus your attention if you hear South Carolina won?
What they did to win.
Exactly. Same game, where are we focusing our attention? So this brings us to Daniel Kahneman. So Daniel Kahneman, in his book Thinking Fast and Slow, has this really cool example with the World Cup. And what he says is this. You mind reading this for me?
Italy and France competed in the 2006 World Cup. The next two sentences both describe the outcome. Italy won, France lost.
And here's the big question. Do those statements mean the same thing? And so what Kahneman suggests is for economists, yes, of course. It's just describing the world. But for most humans, those mean very different things. So you want to mind reading what Italy won evokes?
Italy won.
And just a side note, I love the Italian team, particularly because their uniforms, they look like they could go clubbing. Like once they go from the field, I think they could go downtown Chicago and go out to a club. But then what about France lost?
France lost to both the loss of the French team and wanted to lose, including the memorable headbutt of an Italian player by the French star Zinedine Zidane.
Keep going.
In terms of the associations they bring to mind, the two systems.
Right. Again, where are we focusing the reader's attention? Do we want to talk about the celebration? Do we want to talk about all the things that Italy did to win? Or do we want to focus the readers on all the mishaps that France made? Another example. So suppose you're the head of the Nike ad campaign in 1996, and you want to come up with a real cool commercial that says, look, we are only about winners. You come up with this, under Lisa Leslie, one of their really great women's basketball players, they have this. You mind reading this for me?
Sure. You don't win silver, you lose gold.
So what is that saying? Why are they? What are they focusing on there?
What are they focusing on? They're focusing on the Olympic medals and how you, basically where you put your attention.
Yeah, why? What is their view of somebody who comes in second place?
It's sort of irrelevant.
Yeah, it's sort of like you lost. It's not that you're the second best player on the entire world, or the second best sprinter, the second best swimmer. You've lost gold. The Detroit Free Press had an opportunity to do the same thing. So Michigan in 2013 made it all the way to the NCAA basketball final game, and they lost. So they could have, in the Detroit Free Press, write this. Emily, you want to read that for us?
No, in second place, you lose first.
So why would that be a terrible headline in the Detroit Free Press?
It's really depressing.
Yeah, you might get fired if you did that. That would be a bad move. But it's the same thing structurally as the Nike campaign. Instead, the Detroit Free Press did something really, really sort of humane and brilliant. They did this. Emily, you want to read that for us? And you're smiling. Why is that a really clever headline?
Well, you know the history of Michigan. Like the fact that we made it to the NCAA finals was a miracle in and of itself.
And what they're focusing on is, look, all this season you were so good that you made it to the final game. This is something to celebrate. It's not something to be disappointed by. And then just fill in people who don't go into Michigan. Why is this part of the headline, Hail, Hail, particularly clever?
It's part of our fight song.
Yeah. Who's the audience? What's the function? If you're talking to people who know about Michigan, you throw in a little illusion. In my undergraduate class at Michigan, we call this a little culture kick. When you're throwing in something in culture that adds a little oomph to the headline. So I know the University of Chicago, not necessarily the most athletic sports place. So we have some examples from the world of entertainment. In the 2013 Golden Globes, Bill Clinton was asked to be a presenter. And I think he presented about the movie Lincoln. He described what that movie was about. And it was a big deal. He came out, people were cheering, everyone was sort of excited after he left. And so Amy Poehler tries to capture this excitement. And she says this, "Wow, what an exciting special guest. That was Hillary Clinton's husband." Why is that a brilliant force of focus move? Right here.
It surprises the audience, not what they expect she's going to say.
Yeah, what do they expect her to say?
Former President Bill Clinton.
Yeah, all these things that we could focus on about this person, but we choose something that defines him by his wife. To say the coolest thing about this person who used to be the leader of the free world is that he's married to someone cooler. Think about this anytime you have a client. You have clients who are multi-dimensional. They could be fathers. They could be sons. They could be uncles. They might not be just a criminal. That's something that we work with all the time, the Child Welfare Clinic. We represent parents who are often incarcerated. We have to focus on a different aspect of their life. If we just say criminal, if we just say defendant, we're going to paint a picture that potentially we don't want. Think about this all the time. All right, so another sort of focus, just keep, it requires a little background. So Yale and Harvard played a football game in 1968, and everybody knows about this game, just keep it to yourself because it ruins the punchline. But generally, Yale and Harvard, not necessarily athletic powerhouses. In 1968, both of them were. They were both 6-0 going into this game, which turned out to be the most exciting game of all time. So 6-0 going into the game. Yale is the better team in this game. They go up 22-0 in the second quarter, partly on the strength of their quarterback, Brian Dowling, who had not lost a football game since the seventh grade. He wasn't a really big dude. He was just a winner. And he was also immortalized. Like, he was this big guy on Yale's campus. Doonesbury cartoon puts him into an actual cartoon. If you ever read Doonesbury and you see the guy with the Yale helmet and number 10, that's Brian Dowling. Gary Trudeau was at Yale at this time. So they have Brian Dowling. They also have Kelvin Hill. So Kelvin Hill went on to play for the Dallas Cowboys, not necessarily something that generally happens when you go to Yale to jump to the NFL, but he did. Kelvin Hill was a really solid NFL football player, and he also had a son named Grant Hill. So NCAA champion at Duke, particularly relevant to us at Michigan. He was an NBA All-Star and the Detroit Pistons. And then the coolest thing about Grant Hill is that he won an ugly sweater contest with his father, Calvin Hill. So they have Brian Dowling, they have Calvin Hill, and they have this guy named Bob Levin, who you probably haven't heard of, but he's got an interesting story. And all these stories you can check out by looking at the documentary about this film, or about this game, which I highly recommend. So Bob Levin, what's interesting about him is that he has this Hollywood connection. So he's at Yale, and his girlfriend at the time is Meryl Streep.
Oh, shit.
Yeah! That's what I thought, too. She was at Vassar. So Bob Levin has this connection to Hollywood. I'm telling you, it's the most exciting game of all time. Harvard also has a Hollywood connection in this game. And the Hollywood connection is actually one of their players. So do you know who this is? Will this help? Yeah, Tommy Lee Jones is an offensive lineman for Harvard. If you ever want an indication of how the game of football has changed in 30 years, compare that offensive lineman to the current Bears offensive lineman. There's probably a difference about 150 pounds and maybe a foot. So Tommy Lee Jones is there, and he also has a kind of, not necessarily love interest, we'll say a bromance. Not with Hollywood, but with the White House. So do you know who Tommy Lee Jones' Harvard roommate was back in the corner? Yeah, Al Gore. Tommy Lee Jones's roommate. So Al Gore is potentially invested in this game. There's also a White House connection on the Yale side. So this guy, Bob Livingston, that's actually not him, it's just an old picture that I figure we could pretend it's Bob Livingston. So Bob Livingston's roommate, you knew Tommy Lee Jones in the back. Do you know Bob Livingston's roommate at Yale? George Bush. So we could refocus this game. The Yale-Harvard game in 1968, actually, Bush v. Gore. In important respect, it ended in a tie. The game actually ended in a tie. It started out 22-0. At halftime, it was still 22-6. In the fourth quarter, it was 29-13. With 42 seconds left, still 29-13. But Harvard scores a touchdown, gets a two-point conversion, does an onside kick, recovers it, scores another touchdown, two-point conversion. The game ends 29-29. Your job right now, write the headline. Take a couple minutes. See if you can compose the headline of all the things that we were talking about. We said Michigan, bitter defeat. South Carolina, thrilling victory, same game. You are an editor at the Harvard Crimson. Your audience is the Harvard fans who just watch your team come back from, 16 points down in 42 seconds. What are you going to put in that headline? You're the lawyer for this paper, essentially. These are your clients. Really try and do this in the next minute. Come up with a headline to capture, to make order out of this chaos. You can just do it to yourself. If you have a piece of paper, you can even try that. And I'm not going to call anybody to tell you your headline. I know it's tough to come up with on the spot. But I pressure you to do this because one of the things with writing is you have to do it. You got to take these principles and actually try them. So I'm not going to ask you for any of yours. I'll just go through some of the ones that my students have come up with in the past. So Emily, I go back to you. Harvard comeback stuns Yale. What's good about that headline? Exactly. What you're focusing on is not that first half where you went down 22-0. What you're focusing on is the comeback. And what I love about that is the force of focus. You could reframe that a different way. Anytime there's a comeback, there's also a collapse. Every time there's this great recovery, somebody choked. But what are you going to focus on? So that one's a really good headline. This is even better, Emily. Thrilling fourth quarter rally preserves undefeated season. What's great about that force of focus move?
It's all positive. They're still undefeated.
Yeah, it's not that we didn't win. We're still undefeated. That's what we want to focus your attention on. That's really, really, really great. So this is all examples of good writing. I'm going to show you great writing, the actual headline. Harvard beats Yale 29-29. Why is that great writing, Emily?
Funny.
Yep. Exactly, exactly. And when you're talking about leadership, if you're talking about taking control of an experience, that's the control you want. To say, look, here was this crazy game, here's how you should think about it. What you should think about it, or how you should think about it, is as a victory, right? And you don't have to do that. That headline could be something else. That's really, really wonderful. And it's all an example of what we talked about. The best words in the best order. Think about that headline if it led with 29-29. That wouldn't be the best words in the best order. That might be a little confusing. 29-29 is that great punchline after you have Harvard beats Yale. Getting something right in language. As Emily said, look, it captures the experience of what it actually felt like to be in that game. It's getting something right in language, and then certainly making order out of chaos. You can imagine being at this game and thinking to yourself, what just happened? And then someone really clever says, Harvard just beat Yale, 29-29. And you say, yes. So these definitions of advocacy, these definitions of leadership, Anybody recognize them? Best words in the best order, William Wordsworth, defining poetry. Getting something right in language, Howard Neveroff, poet laureate of the United States, defining poetry. Making order out of chaos, every poet ever, including Dr. Seuss, defining poetry. And it's the sense of when we write, maybe we can try and be a little bit poetic. And it's something that's really neat for all of you here at the University of Chicago. You have this course available to you called Law and Literature. Is anyone taking that right now? So I encourage you in your next years to seek this class out. It's taught by Martha Nussbaum and Judge Posner. It's one of the Greenberg seminars, or at least it has been offered in the past. Is it offered this year? I don't want to false advertising. We'll see. But if it's available, I would definitely check it out, because one of the things that it adds to your education is this. It gives you writing that's not legal writing and has you read it. Emily, why is it important to read non-legal writing when you're in law school?
I just started, so I don't know yet.
Well, have you started reading casebooks?
I have.
And what do you think of the writing in all of those casebooks? They can be. Not all of them. We're going to show you throughout this workshop over in the winter and the spring, really good examples of legal writing. But some of it is very dry and dense. So you need to sort of break out of it. And that's what Judge Posner and Martha Nussbaum offered us. When I took it, we got to read Milton, we got to read Shakespeare, and we also got to read this guy named Tom Stoppard. And what I love about Tom Stoppard is, well, many things, but he has a wonderful way of thinking about the force of focus. And so in this play, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead, he has this statement. Emily, you want to read that for us?
Well,
can
every exit is being an entrance somewhere else?
Why is that a wonderful force of focus move?
It changes basically your concept. Like, it's kind of saying, like, when every door closes, another one opens, but much
nicer. Yeah, and we can think of it just in a more literal aspect. I mean, I'm very much literal fact sections of briefs. You could think about, look, I am exiting room 5. That could be a description of what I'm doing if I walk out of this room. But you could also focus that on I'm entering the hall. And maybe there are different reasons why you want to focus your attention in certain ways. So really good thing. Look on every exit as being an entrance somewhere else. So we're going to show you a way that we actually use this force of focus principle when we are putting together this textbook, or these four leading human trafficking lawyers put together this textbook. But first I want to tell you a little story. So it's a story about how I had a stalker when I went to Scotland. So I went to the University of Chicago as an undergraduate, and I played soccer. And then I actually got to go play soccer afterwards in Scotland. Like, it was like the 15th division in Scotland, but in my head, I was a professional soccer player. And I got up every morning, I put on my shin guards, and I went to work. And in the first couple weeks, I noticed I had, or what I thought was, a stalker. And the stalker was related to this house. So I needed a place to stay, and somebody on the team said, there's this wonderful woman named Barbara Stewart who has a guest house, so you should go check it out. I said, great, I need a place to stay, this woman seems wonderful, I'm gonna go. And that's her house. It was a bed and breakfast. I walk up, there's really nice smells coming from the kitchen, I see sort of like hear kids playing around, seems like an ideal place, until I open the door and I see this. And that's me. That's also me. And that's on a wall. I've never met this woman, so I'm a little creeped out. And I think to myself, why are there pictures of me in this woman's house? Emily, do you have any explanation for why she was actually creeped out when she saw me?
She's
not related to the other player in that picture. Yeah, that's Scotty, her son. She almost punched me in the face. And it's a really good reminder of the force of focus, not only in the sense of who do you focus on in that picture, but also in a more like moral sense of you are not the center of the universe, Patrick Barry. It took me 22 years of my life to figure that out, but it's always important. How are we looking at these photographs? How are we looking at these fact sections? How are we looking at the world? We can look at them in different ways. All right, so The Human Trafficking Textbook. The lead author on this was Bridget Carr. She's the director of the first human trafficking clinic in the country at the University of Michigan. Another author is Ann Milgram. She teaches at NYU. She was the former Attorney General of New Jersey. Then Kathleen Kim, who is the first Skadden Fellow to do a human trafficking project. She now teaches at Loyola. And Steve Warnath, who is the first human trafficking expert, sort of like only the domestic policy advisor or something, created a position in the White House just to study human trafficking. So the big, big leaders in human trafficking, and what they're really concerned about is sort of like, what is the language we use to talk about this really controversial subject? So we're going to work through some of the language of the textbook. This is the first lines in the textbook. Do you mind reading that for us? So why do you think the authors decided to start with labor trafficking? And to give you a little context about sex trafficking, I bring in Bridget to my undergraduate class at Michigan, and she asks the students, so what do you know about human trafficking? And their response is the movie Taken. Right? In everybody's mind, human trafficking is sex trafficking. And in a lot of people's minds, human trafficking is sort of like really good, privileged white women who get trafficked in Eastern European countries. Like, from this movie, that would be our perception. So why are they very concerned about putting labor trafficking at the beginning of this textbook?
It reframes it so you're thinking about not just like sex trafficking, but labor in general.
Exactly. And we know that labor trafficking is actually much more prevalent than sex trafficking. It's not. Now, later in the book, they talk a lot about sex trafficking, but right from the beginning, we want to say, look, this is going to be a leading book in this field. We want to make sure to signal. How about this one? Labor trafficking touches many aspects of our daily lives. It touches through supply chains, the t-shirts we wear, the cell phones we use, and the chocolate we eat and share with others. Compare that to that one. You want to read that one? Why did we go with the first one?
Because it doesn't like otherize the problem. It like brings you. It brings everyone into it.
Yeah, that we're implicated. We use cell phones when we were putting together this textbook. We ate chocolate. We wore t-shirts. And this part is something that if you go into public interest work, be very, very concerned about, which is the concern of becoming and communicating self-righteousness. Right? It's always really easy to slip into the position of, you people are doing these wrong things, I'm so high and mighty. What the authors did was this wonderful thing, is say, look, here's a problem that we all are involved in. Maybe we can all fight to stop. Really nice. Another choice. It touches through supply chains, the t-shirts we wear, the cell phones we use, and the chocolate we eat and share with others. Read that one. Why is the first one better?
It makes you like visualize it more.
Yeah, so this is another concept we talk about. Not only the force of focus, but the power of the particular. That everybody can sort of visualize a cell phone, or chocolate, or a t-shirt. Whereas products we use is true, not visual. So there's a neat little story about the chocolate one. So I originally wanted cherry tomatoes. It was a different sentence, but I put in cherry tomatoes. And the authors are really wise in pushing back on that. Why? Why would cherry tomatoes be sort of, what do you think their concerns were? Yeah, so we're always talking about, and when we hear things like cherry tomatoes, we might think Whole Foods. Whereas the authors wanted a more general audience. They wanted people at Jewel. They wanted people at Walmart. They wanted people at Treasure Island, America's most European of supermarkets. No, but this is like this really serious point. There was a long email exchange just about this word. Because there's a sense of, look, we want to reach everybody. The words you choose can change the world people see. Okay, so it's not as if we just focus only on labor trafficking. We have to get to sex trafficking. So read this sentence. This is the next sentence in the textbook.
Moreover, sex trafficking intertwines with much of the global sex industry, whether through the sale of young males in brothels in Bangalore, the sale of young females into strip clubs in San Diego, or the forced prostitution of both males and females of all ages in states across the country and countries across the world.
So why do we focus the first on the sale of young males? Exactly. So we do talk about young women, but we also talk about all ages. And for this reason, which is it's not just teenagers. One of the recent projects of the folks at the Human Trafficking at Michigan was they were part of this raid of a massage parlor. And some of the trafficked victims were in their 40s and 50s. And so what they wanted to do with this casebook is to say, look, this is a larger problem than we're currently seeing it as. And it all happens through language. So it's the force of focus. We start out with young males. We're not talking about young females, but we want to, as you said, sort of like go against the conventional wisdom if the conventional wisdom's a little off. And often with these textbooks is against our question. Who's the audience? What's the function? So who's the audience of a human trafficking textbook? Yeah, lawyers and law students. And what is the function?
Teaching them about the issues surrounding practicing that area of law.
Exactly. Or maybe we turned it, shape the conversation. So think about this, of your contracts books, your property books. They could be written a different way. How are they trying to shape your view of how to think about contracts? How are they trying to shape your view of how to think about property or civil procedure? These are all choices that affect you. All right, brothels in Bangalore. Why? Well, let's talk about this. Brothels in Bangalore and strip clubs in San Diego. Why those two power the particular moves?
It brings an international focus, but also a closer focus.
Yeah, exactly. That you wouldn't want to keep them just all in Asia or all outside of the US. You want to bring them into a sphere that says, look, this is in our own backyard. So I want to focus on these power of the particulars just because it will give you a sense of where you can potentially go wrong and why you might choose. So we chose Bangalore, but anytime you have a detail like this, you can think of the power particular sort of like Google Maps. Like you can go in closer and closer and closer, or you can go out farther and farther away. So with Bangalore, we could have said, look, brothels in India. We could have scaled that Google map out a little bit more. We could say, okay, well maybe we want to say brothels in Asia. Or we could even scale it out with sort of like brothels in the solar system. But considering we don't know about human traffickers in Jupiter, we wanted to keep it a little bit more close. And so think about that. When do you want to go general? When do you want to go specific? So with San Diego, we could have gone more specific. We could have said, look, on North Harbor Drive, there's human trafficking. Or some dude's garage. But again, that's not necessarily going to appeal to enough people. Always think about these choices. What are the facts that you want to focus on in a specific way? What are the facts that you want to focus on in a general way? And we know from the force of focus that we can sort of reframe then in many different ways. All right, so we have these two things, the force of focus and the power of the picture, and they all kind of come together with this guy, Josh Gibson. So Josh Gibson was one of the best baseball players of all time, but he never played in the major leagues. He played in what were the Negro Leagues, because for a while, you couldn't be black and be in the Major League Baseball. So Josh Gibson is a really kind of cool indication of the force of focus in that he has this amazing career, almost 800 home runs, career average of 359. In 1 year, he hit 467 and 55 home runs. Like, just a beast. And so about him, they said this. You want to read that for us?
The Black Babe Ruth.
Why do they think they called him the Black Babe Ruth? Right, so they're trying to kind of find some reference for who this person is. Can we think about how to refocus it? We could call Josh Gibson the Black Babe Ruth, but we could also call Babe Ruth
the Black, the White Josh Gibson.
Yeah, what would we be doing there? Great, so that's the question of who's the audience? Do people know about this? Is it something that we could do without sort of confusing people? But what's nice about restructuring it is the power dynamic. It's not just, look, every black athlete, we're gonna find the white better representative and put them in reference. No, we say, you know what? If you want to understand what Babe Ruth looked like, he was sort of like the white Josh Gibson. That Josh Gibson becomes the standard, Babe Ruth becomes the sort of thing you reference against. It's a really, really nice move. So Michigan has this, often called the Harvard of the Midwest, right? So they have their t-shirts going around. Well, I'll show you the different version of it. So John F. Kennedy comes to Michigan in 1960, and he's appearing at the Michigan Union, and he tries to describe where he went to school, which is Harvard. And what he says is this, Emily. Yeah, what is he saying there? Why is he doing that to a Michigan audience?
Well, like you were saying with the description, it makes Michigan feel like better than Harvard. Like, oh, Harvard's trying to be like us.
Exactly. And so now we have t-shirts walking around. I don't think if you go into Cambridge, there are t-shirts that say Harvard, the Michigan of the East. But we can see this impulse. It's a nice way of reframing a relationship. And we can always do that. So another way of thinking about this is actually through Abby Wambach. So Abby Wambach is the was the 2012 World Player of the Year. She was a two-time Olympic champion. She won an ESPY. But the coolest thing about Abby Wambach, at least in my mind, is that she was a Brighton Kamikaze. So she was an under 12 Brighton Kamikaze. She was the only girl on this boys' team. That's her. And she was by far the best player on this team. And I know that because I was also a Brighton Kamikaze. Here's a better photo of it. This is like my Force of Focus version of team way down here, me way up here. And so I tell my undergraduates this story, and I say, like, let's talk about this in terms of Force of Focus. Because there's occasions, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, where I might see Abby out in Rochester, New York, where we both grew up. I'd see her potentially at a bar, and I'd say to undergraduates, sort of like, look, think about this conversation. And I would say to Abby, I would say, remember, you played on my team when we were 12. Now, Emily, read her potential response. So what is Abby doing in the terms of Force of Focus?
She's taking over ownership of the team. You're less than her.
Exactly. And I definitely am less than Abby Wambach. And so I asked the students, so which is more true? Is it that Abby played on Mr. Barry's team, or is it that Mr. Barry played on Abby's team? It's a silly example, but always super important. Where are you focusing the reader's attention? So another thing I like about Josh Gibson is we can talk about him with the power of the particular. We could say about him, particularly if we look at this photo where he really looks like a beast, even his hair had muscles. Right? So this is something that was actually said. Even his hair has muscles. And so you want to talk to me through, why is that better than writing the sentence, he was really strong? Well, we'll go back to the power particular. You were saying before, why is that a better image? Even his hair had muscles.
It just like really emphasizes, it creates a better picture in your head of like how strong he really was.
Right. And it's got the absurd notion of sort of like hair doesn't have muscles. But on this dude, his hair probably has muscles. So this wasn't actually said about Josh Gibson. It was said about Jimmy Fox, who I mention because he was a player on the Boston Red Sox when Ted Williams joined the team. And Ted Williams became one of the best hitters in baseball, maybe the most natural, gifted hitters. Or at least we think about him in terms of having natural talent. But one of the things he did is something that we can kind of learn from, which is every day he went to batting practice and watched Jimmy Fox. Why do you think he did that?
To be better, to learn more.
Yeah, and so sort of we could have this principle. Read that. And it's similar to Charlie Parker. So Charlie Parker is this wonderful jazz musician. And one of his first jobs he took as, I think, a dishwasher in Charlie's Chicken Shack in New York City, where he got maybe like $9 a week. And the reason he went there is because they had really good musicians playing. And so we could have this principle from the realm of music.
Play good music, you need to listen to good music.
Or from the world of painting. So Edouard Manet, during his career, he registered as a copyist at the Louvre. And he went in and he just studied the great paintings. And so we have this principle.
Paint good paintings, you need to see good paintings.
And so with my undergraduate students at Michigan and with the law students at Michigan, we say it works the same way in writing. Our principle?
To write good sentences, you need to read good sentences.
And it gets back to the law and literature course, because a lot of the case books don't necessarily have good sentences. And so if you're reading bad sentences all day, you produce bad sentences all day. And so one of the things I want you to do, or what I want to do with this course, is introduce you to good sentences. And if we can come up with principles of why they're good sentences, we have this principle of the power of the particular. So read that sentence for me. So this is an advertisement for Rolls-Royce. Well, I'll actually read it. At 60 miles an hour, the loudest noise in this Rolls-Royce comes from the electric clock. Why is that a great advertisement? Why is that a great sentence? Yeah, sorry, I was going with you, right in the front row.
Oh, because it's kind of exciting. You think a big car going fast is going to make a lot of noise.
But
it's the clock.
Yeah, that's the only thing you can hear. So we can compare that to, this car is really quiet. That's a bad promotion. Next one, the first sentence of 1984. And so now you. You want to read that for us? Compare that to this bad sentence. Things were weird. Why is that a bad sentence?
It doesn't say what type of things were weird.
Yeah, why is this a great sentence?
Because you don't think of the clock going all the way up to 13.
Exactly. You create an image in the reader's head. You don't say, I'm introducing you to the strange world. You just give them the strangeness, and it's so much better. Gabriel Garcia Marquez, anybody speak Spanish? Yes, great. So you want to read the first line of 100 Years of Solitude?
In English?
No, Spanish. We'll get you English in a second. Now you didn't want to volunteer. It's sort of like, yeah, I didn't speak Spanish. Go. Now in English? Right, and again, firing squad, ice. Introduce you into this world of magical realism, not by saying, here's a book about magical realism. No, I'm going to say that part of this was my remembering firing squad and also the introduction of when I discovered ice. What a cool, cool line. Though here's perhaps my favorite from an Australian writer, a memoir about her journey through much of Australia, and she leads off with this. You want to read this? Keep going. And again, at 5 a.m., not in the morning, with a dog, $6, not just some money, and then my favorite, inappropriate clothes. Like, what is that? You want to keep reading. Same thing in the political realm. When we're talking about leadership, we're talking about how can we create images. So in 1961, JFK is trying to get America to enter space. He wants to come up with something really ambitious. And what he says is this, I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal sometime in the future of increasing space exploration, accelerating technological advancement. No, he doesn't say that. That would be a terrible thing to say. What he says is this, I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. And so let's just break this apart and sort of like, man, moon, get there. That's particular. That's leadership. That's something that people can really understand. And let's break these down into a sentence level so that you can do this on your own. Bad is, I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal sometime in the future. Why is that bad, sometime in the future? Yeah, so much better before this decade is out. And talk to Dean Garner about what her experience in as a partner in a law firm. If you say, yeah, I kind of want this, oh, I don't know, whenever, that's really frustrating. But if you say, no, by Wednesday, that's when we need it. Here's a concrete deadline. This is something particular. This is something that we can get behind. I believe this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal sometime in the future of increasing space exploration. It's so indefinite. We don't know when that goal is reached. Much better if we say, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon. We can all get behind this detail. The final part of it, accelerating technological advancement. These are the words that appear in our casebooks. These are the words that are familiar to the lawyers. But if you're JFK's speechwriter, not good enough. You also don't just want to put the person on the moon, you want to bring them back. And what happened is really nice. So JFK gave a speech, May 25th, 1961, moon landing. within a decade. That's really cool. Not just the Democrats who are doing this, particularly Ronald Reagan. June 12th, 1987, right in the Brandenburg Gate in West Berlin. What he does not say is this. You want to read that for us?
Mr. Gorbachev, please begin the elimination of the elaborate and inefficient system of totalitarian government that is currently resulting in the censorship of the press, the stagnation of your economy, and the oppression of millions of people.
Which, if you hired a 1L to write that speech, that's what they write. Because they'd want to sound smart and they put in big words. But Ronald Reagan says this.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Exactly, and that's why we call him the great communicator. Because he's standing right there and he comes up with something particular to rally people. One way to think about this is through the poet William Carlos Williams. And he has this great idea of the sense of no ideas but in things. Get something concrete. Get something particular. We can get it from writing guides. The elements of style have this. The greatest writers are effective largely because they deal in particulars. Not in generalities, but in particulars. And Justice Roberts. You want to read Justice Roberts for us?
Sure. You're looking for a couple of hooks in the facts that are hopefully going to be repeated in one form or another later on in the legal argument, but also are going to catch some presenters. Give judges some hook, and it helps draw them into the brief.
So we know at the appellate level, if you're reading these briefs over and over again, and now that I'm a clerk, I have to read briefs over and over again. If you give me some hook, if you give me some detail about your client that turns them human, I'm going to pay attention more. That's what Justice Roberts is getting at. Also happens at the trial level. So Sotomayor, in her memoir, My Beloved Country, or My Beloved World, she talks about her experience as a trial lawyer. And what she says is this. You want to read it? Sorry, that's a typo. Feel.
Feel the cold blade held against their necks or the unappreciated devotion that might drive someone to steal from a former employer. In examining witnesses, I learned to ask general questions so as to elicit details with powerful sensory associations, the colors, the sounds, the smells that lodge an image in the mind and put the listener in the burning house.
And then she just puts it into this nice phrase.
Is the particulars that
she doesn't capitalize it or put exclamation points, but we should. So we remember, put in particulars. If you're writing appellate briefs, if you're on a closing statement, or even examining witnesses. That's what I love about that example. You might not think when you're examining witnesses, tell a story that's particular. Great. So one of my undergraduates, they write not appellate briefs, but they write essays, and I tell them, strive for five. A lot of people, when they're writing essays, just focus on the visuals. I say, no. Focus on all five senses. Give me something that I can see, yes. Give me something that I can also hear. If you are talking about crime, talk to me about the sounds in that congested room. What was it like? What was that panic like? Give me some smells. If you're doing a drug bust, give me some sense of what it smells like to be in a meth lab. And give me touch and give me taste. So try to do this, particularly in your legal writing. You get focused on the see if you can expand your senses. All right, so we have this principle. The words you choose can change the world people see. And I just say it over and over again so that you remember. And we had Michigan lost, South Carolina won. We had President of the United States or Hillary Clinton's husband. We had every exit is also an exit. So they have the words you choose can change the world people see. Except it's more complicated than that. It's actually this. You want to read that?
The order of the words you choose can change the world people see.
Yeah, and so for that, we can get a little help from Joan Didion. So Joan Didion is a wonderful writer. If you're looking for good sentences to emulate, check out her books. One is called The Year of Magical Thinking, about the death of her husband. Another is called Blue Nights, about the death of her daughter. And the one we're going to talk about, or at least draw from, is Slouching Towards Bethlehem, when she had these amazingly fantastic and stylish sunglasses. So she has this in Slouching Towards Bethlehem. All I know about grammar is its infinite power. To shift the structure of a sentence alters the meaning of that sentence, as definitely and inflexibly as the position of a camera alters the meaning of the object photographed. Many people know about camera angles now, but not so many know about sentences. And that's what we want to think about. Think about all those force of focus moves as sort of like, where do we want to direct the camera? Where do we want our reader to focus? We can talk about this through the context of OCI. So it seems like most of you are sort of 1Ls. You haven't gone through OCI yet, but maybe you've heard of it, where a bunch of law firms and organizations come on campus and it's really neat because you get to present your best self to them, or maybe your most anxious self to them. But you'll go through this at some point. And we're not going to talk about your experience because it might be too stressful. We'll talk about it in terms of Elle Woods from Legally Blonde. And imagine if Elle Woods hears this when she gets done with her interview. You want to read that for us?
We still have 15 people to interview Elle, but we really want to hire you.
Or she hears this. Why should would she be psyched to hear the first one?
Because the structure makes it seem like, even though we still have more people to interview, we really want to hire you.
Why would she be bummed to hear the second one?
The structure flips it, so it sounds like we want to hire you, but there's still other people that we have to consider.
Exactly. But nothing about those words are different. Those are the same exact words. Same amount of words, same actual words. The only thing that's different is the order of the sentence. So when I talk this to the undergraduates, they have no idea what OCI is, but they do know what dating is. So I say, okay, imagine you're going on your first date and you're not really sure how it went. Like, there were some laughs, there were some awkward spells. You're trying to get a gauge of what this person thinks of you, and you hear this. Read that.
I'm really interested in you, Elle, but I'm also really busy this semester.
Or you hear this. Why would you be bummed to hear the first one? Yeah, you give the sense of, yes, I'm interested in you, but with the second one, you're like, second date. I got a second date. Silly example, but helpful. This is something that I've noticed with students miss all the time. The way that grammar, the term for this is syntax. And in my courses, I make that the title. I teach a course called The Syntax of Sports. And I also teach a course called The Syntax of Slavery, so that my students will remember the order of sentences really can change the world people see, just like the actual words can. So that brings us to the final thing, which is sort of words to write by. Can I read this?
Sometimes you have to remind yourself, I can't do everything, but I can do more than I think. And sometimes you have to remind yourself, I can do more than I think, but I can't.
Oh, sorry, typo. Like, I can't fix the typos in my presentations. It's up to you to figure out which one of those times this is. And I bring this up because one of the most frequent conversations I have with lawyers in Las Vegas and the judges, and also with teachers at Chicago and Michigan, is a conversation about balance, right? It's sort of like, how do I do all the things that I want to do? And there's a nice way that the force of focus actually gives you a sort of option for thinking about this problem of how do I balance trying to be a really superstar student, which also being an actual person? How do I try and advance my career without ruining all my relationships? So the negotiation expert at Harvard, he's part of the Harvard Negotiation Project. He has this book. I mean, it's kind of got a gimmicky title, but the insights in it are really wonderful. So he says the power of a positive no. And the way he defines a positive no is this. You want to read that?
Every no is a yes someplace else.
What do you think he means by that? So this is a guy who gets asked to do all sorts of things. Everybody wants to come have him talk. Everybody wants to have him co-author their article. And he feels really bad. He seems like a really genuine guy saying no. But he has to remind himself what? Exactly. Maybe it's another project. Maybe it's hanging out with his wife. Maybe it's sleeping. That could be an option for all of you. Every time you say no to something, yes could be, I want to take a nap. And it's something that I noticed at Michigan, particularly at the undergraduate level. And so I made an assignment where, well, that's a little preview. But what I said is, look, you're coming into this course, you have to write every day, you have to write every week. Where you have an assignment every week, you have to make drafts. So it's probably essentially three assignments every week. They end up writing something like, I don't know, 300 to 400 pages. And they're writing, and reading. They're working really, really hard. And I say one of the most important assignments, maybe the most important assignment, is you have to pick one of the assignments and tell me you're not going to do it. Not only that, you have to tell me what you're going to do instead. So that you get practice at something that will be important in life school, which is prioritizing and having the ability to say, you know what? No to that, yes to something else. They really struggle with this assignment. All the people at Michigan, like the people at Chicago, valedictorians of their high school, super high achievers. They don't like to say no. They certainly don't like to say no to their teachers. But with a little prodding, they get into it. So here's an email that I actually got. You want to read that for us?
Instead of writing paper for the rest of the afternoon, I'm going to study for my calc exam, which is on Monday.
Which is a good indication of sort of like, I'm saying no to this assignment, I'm doing yes to that assignment. But fortunately, she goes on. Keep going.
Also, I can now call my mom back.
That's amazing!
Something I haven't seemed to be able to do for the past week. And to be honest, I'm also going to use the time to do absolutely nothing for a little while. Just sit back, veg, and maybe watch the Michigan game. Have a nice weekend.
Yeah, and she is a really wise student because she came to that conclusion of sense of, I really like this class, I really want to improve my writing, but there's other things that I want to do with my life, at least for this week. And so I know that there are other ways you could have spent this hour. There are other ways that you could spend the next 3 years at the University of Chicago instead of sort of investing in your writing. I would encourage you. What I've seen in terms of working at the law clinic, what I've seen in terms of clerking, what I've seen in talking to people who work in all sorts of legal fields, the investment you put into your writing really, really, really does pay off. And so I hope that when you have a choice, when it comes to the winter and spring, you potentially consider saying yes to the next version of this workshop. Thank you.